Okay, good evening, everybody. After a very enjoyable talk by Dr. Sujoy on ulcerative colitis, we'll now discuss extrahepatic portal vein obstruction, selection of the appropriate procedure, and if time permits, the preoperative preparation and the postoperative management protocol. So because we have a very variegated audience, my endeavor has been to touch upon the basics and also upon the most recent concepts of EHPVO so that there is a message hopefully for all for trainees of all levels of seniority. So this is the outline of presentation. Role of surgery for extrahepatic portal vein obstruction in the endotherapy era. What have been the various schools of thought? Then decision-making on what is the right surgical procedure in a given clinical scenario, which is governed by the anatomy of the porto-spleno-mesenteric venous system, the indications for surgery, and an understanding of the advantages and limitations of each surgical procedure, wherein I will discuss the standard porto-systemic shunts, the mesorex bypass, and also address the debate of standard porto-systemic shunts versus mesorex bypass, the crucial question as to what is the role of standard portosystemic shunts with the emergence of mesorex bypass. And then if time permits, then we will discuss key points in the preoperative preparation and postoperative management protocol. And then from our experience, I have selected some representative case capsules with a message. So depending on the philosophy of management of EHPVO in a given center, there are three approaches to the role of surgery in the management of EHPVO. Approach one is offering total portosystemic shunt for every patient following endoscopic control of first major bleed episode. Approach two is the Baveno 6 guidelines, which recommend a mesorex bypass, not only for secondary, but also for primary prophylaxis for every EHPVO case. The middle path is the one that we have been following at SGPGIMS so far, that is surgical intervention for select indications post-endoscopic eradication of gastroesophageal varices. So what determines the most appropriate surgical procedure in a given patient? It is the anatomy of the portospleno-mesenteric venous axis, the indication for surgery, and an understanding of the advantages and limitations of each surgical procedure. And we will begin with the anatomy first. So I have quoted figures from all of series because this is a large series of 200 consecutive patients of EHPVO, wherein the anatomy was assessed by conventional angiography. The celiac artery and the superior mesenteric artery were cannulated and the images were taken in the images were taken in the delayed portal venous phase, and therefore one would expect that the delineation of the anatomy is accurate. So in all of series, the portal vein alone was involved in 70%. In 20%, there was a concomitant involvement of the splenic vein, and in 5%, there was a concomitant involvement of the superior mesenteric vein. And in 10% of the patients, the entire spleno-porto-mesenteric venous axis was thrombosed, and hence the anatomy was not favorable for any of these standard portal decompression procedures. So for preoperative imaging, we begin with an ultrasound with color Doppler as the initial screening investigation, followed by a CT or an MR portovenogram imaging reconstruction for a more precise delineation of the anatomy of the portospleno-mesenteric venous axis, the arterial anatomy and the visceral anatomy. Now, theoretically speaking, both CT and MR are equally good. So the accuracy of information actually depends on the quality of reconstruction and hence the local expertise in a given center. And at our center, we found CT to be more informative. If a mesorex bypass is planned, then the intrahepatic portal venous anatomy is assessed by a wedge hepatic venous portography. An MRCP with MR portovenogram is indicated for mapping of biliary and vascular anatomy. Endoscopic ultrasound has a select role, say in visualization of calculus at the lower end of the CBD or for mapping of intracolitical varices, but this is of more relevance to the endoscopist and is not really a part of our routine preoperative imaging protocol. So ultrasound with color Doppler is a good screening imaging modality for delineating of a portal cavernoma, because the first step is to confirm that the diagnosis is indeed idiopathic extrahepatic portal vein thrombosis and not portal hypertension because of intrahepatic or a posthepatic cause, and also to exclude portal vein thrombosis secondary to a local inflammatory pathology, say a choledochal cyst or chronic pancreatitis or a mast lesion, which could be a HCC in an adult or a hepatoblastoma in a child. In our series, we had a child with a dermoid cyst in the retropancreatic region, which was extending into the hepatoduodenal ligament, and the portal vein thrombosis was possibly secondary to recurrent infections in the dermoid cyst. Then a CT and an MR portovenogram gives a more precise delineation of the anatomy of the two limbs of any portosystemic shunt. The afferent limb, which is constituted by a vein of the portosplenomesenteric venous system, and the efferent limb, which is constituted by a vein of the systemic venous system. So in an abdominal CT or an MR, for the portal venous system, we have to assess the shuntability of the splenic vein and the superior mesenteric vein. Shuntability refers to an adequate diameter, which in our experience, we will say is a diameter of more than 5 millimeter, though this would vary with surgical experience. For instance, in bismuth series, shunts have been created with veins as small as 2 millimeters in diameter, but the shunt block rates are higher with smaller diameter veins. Also, an adequate length is important. For the superior mesenteric vein, the intrapancreatic segment is important because this is the place where the graft is placed. It is also important that the vein should have a regular lumen, meaning thereby that it should not be a partially thrombosed vein. Because if an anastomosis is made with a partially thrombosed, unhealthy vein, then it is unlikely to sustain patency in the long term. Then further, patency of the confluence of the superior mesenteric vein with the splenic vein signifies a favorable anatomy, because it implies that a portal decompression surgery made with either a splenic vein or the superior mesenteric vein is going to decompress all the compartments of the portal venous system. For the systemic venous system, we essentially wish to exclude anomalies of the left renal vein and the inferior vena cava. For instance, the left renal vein normally has a pre-aortic course, but if there is a retroaortic left renal vein, then it limits the amount of length available on the anterior surface of the left renal vein for placement of a splenorenal anastomosis. And in one such case in our series, we had to take recourse to a splenoadrenal shunt because fortunately, the adrenal vein was of a good diameter. Then sometimes the left kidney may be absent, it may be atrophic, or it can be an ectopic left kidney, say a horseshoe kidney, say a pelvic left kidney or a cross-fused renal ectopia, or they can be a horseshoe kidney. And in each of these situations, the left renal vein is not available for the anastomosis at all. And this should not come as a surprise on the operating table in today's era of advanced imaging. And in each of these situations, one will have to plan an alternative surgical strategy wherein the efferent limb is drained into the inferior vena cava. We confirm the patency of all three hepatic veins. The patency of the inferior mesenteric vein assumes importance when the indication for surgery is portal colopathy, because the shunt should decompress the IMV territory. And in exceptional situations like when both the splenic vein and the superior mesenteric vein are not available for a shunt, they are thrombosed, then an inferior mesenteric vein can also be used for a shunt in exceptional circumstances. For a mesorex bypass, the extrahepatic venous anatomy is assessed by an abdominal CT or an MR portovenogram. More important is the intrahepatic portal venous anatomy, which is assessed by a wedge hepatic venous portogram. And the bypass graft is assessed by a Doppler ultrasound of the neck, because the internal jugular vein is the most robust graft. It is also important to exclude hydrocephalus or any pathology that can lead to raised intracranial pressure, because there are isolated case reports of pseudotumor cerebri manifesting after harvesting of the internal jugular vein for a graft, especially when the contralateral IJV is thrombosed because of a prior intervention procedure. So if for anatomical reasons, the IJV cannot be harvested for a graft, Then the alternate veins that have been used are the left gastric vein, the inferior mesenteric vein, or a large collateral in the abdomen. So from the perspective of a Mesorex bypass on an abdominal imaging, we assess the patency and adequate length of the superior mesenteric vein in the intrapancreatic segment, and also the patency of the confluence of the superior mesenteric vein with the splenic vein and the patency of the splenic vein. Because only when this confluence is patent would a Mesorex bypass not only decompress the superior mesenteric circuit, but would also decompress the gastrosplenic circuit. But the limitation of the abdominal CT or an MR is its poor accuracy in delineating the anatomy of the left branch of the portal vein in the rhesus of Rex. This is because the left portal vein in these patients is often very hypoplastic. The sizes usually varies between 2 to 4 millimeters. Then the prograde portal perfusion is poor, as a result of which enough contrast may not reach the left branch of the portal vein to adequately opacify it. And very often, presence of collaterals at the hilum obscure the anatomy in the rhesus of Rex. And therefore, the gold standard for imaging of the intrahepatic portal venous system is a wedge hepatic venous portography. And how is it performed? It is performed by cannulating the right internal jugular vein. The tip of the catheter is advanced into one of the hepatic veins. The contrast is injected under pressure, and that contrast travels through the hepatic sinusoids and opacifies the entire intrahepatic portal venous system. And at the end of the contrast study, wedge hepatic pressure gradients are measured, and a transjugular liver biopsy is taken to confirm that the pathology indeed is EHPVO alone and not EHPVO with concomitant chronic liver disease. So it is worthwhile going over the history of evolution of imaging modalities for intrahepatic portal venous system for Mesorex bypass. So when Dr. Deville Degoyer published his first experience with Mesorex bypass in the year 1992, they began with a preoperative Doppler ultrasonography and combined it with an intraoperative direct portography, meaning thereby that at surgery, they cannulated an umbilical vein, injected contrast through it, and if the anatomy was suitable for a Mesorex bypass, they proceeded with a Mesorex bypass, or else they shifted over to a distal splenorenal shunt. Then over a period of time, the preoperative Doppler ultrasound got augmented with a preoperative CT or an MR portominogram combined with an intraoperative direct portography. And then came percutaneous transhepatic direct portography, wherein under ultrasound guidance, the left branch of the portal vein was directly cannulated and contrast was injected into it. But the limitation of this was that often the left branch of the portal vein is hypoplastic, and therefore it was difficult to cannulate. And sometimes a collateral in the rhesus of Rex was mistaken for the left branch of the portal vein. So as of now, the gold standard for imaging of intrahepatic portal venous system is a wedge hepatic venous portography by transjugular retrograde method. And it should be possible to perform this imaging study by any intervention radiologist who is used to doing TIPS. Now, MRCP with MR portovenogram is indicated for mapping of biliary and vascular anatomy, for symptomatic portal cavernoma cholangiopathy, or even when the patient is asymptomatic but has persistently raised liver enzymes. Vast majority of patients with EHPVO would have cholangiographic evidence of portal cavernoma cholangiopathy. But there are these clinical radiological studies which have shown that there are certain cholangiographic changes which predict a symptomatic or a complicated PCC. And they are a CBD angulation of less than 140 degree at the level of the superior border of the pancreas, because this signifies a fixed stricture. Then a significant biliary dilatation, which in adults has been defined as a diameter of more than 7 millimeters for the CBD and a diameter of more than 4 millimeters for the left and the right hepatic duct, and presence of calculi in the CBD or hepaticolithiasis. So MRCP also has an important therapeutic implication because it serves as a guide for percutaneous or endoscopic intervention if it is warranted, say for acute severe cholangitis or a very high bilirubin associated with impaired synthetic functions of the liver. So after having assessed the anatomy comes an assessment for indication for surgery. Endotherapy leads to obliteration of natural portosystemic collaterals in the gastroesophageal region, but portal pressures continue to be elevated. And therefore, long-term studies following endoscopic eradication of varices from our institution have showed that endotherapy actually leads to exacerbation of isolated gastric varices, manifestation of ectopic varices, vasculopathies in the form of gastropathy, enteropathy, colopathy, issues related to splenomegaly and portal cavernoma cholangiopathy. So indications for surgery in endotherapy era, we can classify as bleed-related indications and non-bleed indications. And bleed-related indications are those wherein endotherapy has failed or the varices are not amenable to endotherapy. And this refers to isolated large gastric fundal or enteral varices, ectopic varices, that is varices which are distal to the stomach, so they could be in the duodenum, the small bowel or anorectal region, or vasculopathies. And about ectopic varices, they bleed less often as compared to esophageal varices, but when they bleed more torrentially. They are obviously difficult to access and control by endoscopy, and therefore they have a higher mortality. Of the non-bleed indications, the commonest in our experience has been splenomegaly-related issues with concomitant growth retardation, which could manifest as clinically symptomatic hypersplenism. The commonest manifestation which we have seen is menorrhagia in adolescent girls. In extreme cases, the patient may present with spontaneous skin bleeds or spontaneous bleed from other mucosal surfaces. Or there could be a large splenic infarct, which can evolve into a splenic abscess, and this can be a challenging problem in the setting of EHPVO. In addition, there is a large subset of patients who have asymptomatic severe hypersplenism, which we define as a platelet count of less than 50,000 and a TLC of less than 2,500. And this affects the quality of life in all domains, that is physical, psychosocial, schooling, because this spleen leads to chronic pain and early satiety. It restricts the physical activity of the child and their concerns are related to trauma. And the impact of massive splenomegaly and growth retardation on quality of life has been very nicely documented by this quality of life study published in JPJ in 2010, again from SGPGIMS. Portal cavernoma cholangiopathy becomes an indication for surgery when it is symptomatic in the form of jaundice, pruritus, or pain. It could get complicated in the form of recurrent cholangitis. It can evolve into secondary biliary cirrhosis, which together with impairment of synthetic functions of the liver, advanced cholangiopathy and a non-shuntable anatomy can actually warrant a liver transplant. But it is equally important to give cognizance to this subset of patients who may be clinically asymptomatic but may have persistently elevated liver enzymes. And it is perhaps prudent to intervene at this stage by portal decompression and not wait till the time the disease evolves into a symptomatic or a complicated disease. And this has been our threshold of intervention in children. And the significance of intervening at this stage is very appropriately highlighted by a French study by Villers et al., which I will present in my subsequent slides. So where does surgery lie in the overall management algorithm of PCC? If a patient presents with one of the complications like cholangitis or high bilirubin with impaired liver synthetic functions, we first begin with optimization by antibiotics and biliary drainage, either by endoscopic or a percutaneous transhepatic route. And after optimization, one needs to plan a portal decompression surgery. This can be a total shunt or a mesorex bypass. A reassessment is made after 6 to 12 months of a well-functioning portal decompression surgery, after which it is expected that 60 to 70% of patients would have resolution of clinical cholestasis. Those that have persistence of clinical cholestasis would merit a second stage hepaticogegastomy. So it is worth emphasizing that any primary biliary drainage surgery without prior portal decompression in EHO is fraught with risk of life-threatening hemorrhage because the CBD is surrounded with high pressure collaterals the strictures are often multiple and they are high and higher in location and therefore difficult to access by surgery. And therefore, portal decompression surgery plays a key role in the surgical management because it relieves biliary obstruction in as many as 60 to 70% of adults and a higher proportion of children. It renders biliary surgery safe in others by decompressing the collaterals. So this slide is a summary of surgical series of adults with portal cavernoma cholangiopathy. The first one is by Dr. Adarsh Chaudhary et al. From GB Panth. And actually this study deserves the credit for being the first study to document a successful approach to management of PCC, which has been a challenging problem. The second series is from SGPGIMS with Professor Vinay Kapoor and Dr. Sadiq being the senior authors. And the third one is a FRIEND study. And in each of these studies, in all patients wherein the anatomy was amenable to a shunt, the first stage was a portosystemic shunt, which constituted 52% to 70% of the patients. The kind of portal decompression surgery performed was a splenorenal shunt, following which resolution of symptoms occurred in 60 to 70% of the patients. In the remaining patients, a safe second stage hepaticogegenostomy could be performed. But it is more important to look at the course of patients wherein direct biliary surgery was attempted without prior portal decompression, either because the anatomy was not shuntable or because of what one can say was a misplaced surgical decision-making in the initial years when the experience with this entity was limited. So in all patients wherein direct biliary surgery without prior portal decompression was attempted, barring one or two patients, it failed. And the surgeon was forced to retract because of life-threatening bleed on the operating table. And there were some intraoperative as well as post-operative bleed-related mortality as well. So this slide actually has a very important message. Now, this study by Willers et al. Is an exclusively pediatric surgical series. 6% of all EHO children warranted surgery for portal cavernoma cholangiopathy, and this corresponds to our experience as well. Age ranging from as young as 4 years to 11 years. Important to note that while in 50% the indication for surgical intervention was symptoms in the form of jaundice and pruritus, in the remaining 50%, they were asymptomatic, but the indication for surgical intervention was persistently elevated liver enzymes. A portal decompression surgery could be performed in all. It was either a mesocaval shunt or a mesorex bypass. And normalization of liver function test occurred in all children at time periods ranging from 1 week to 5 years post-portal decompression. Liver histology, important that it showed varying grades of liver fibrosis in all. And cirrhosis was documented at histology in one child at the age of 10 years who was asymptomatic, but the indication for surgery was persistently raised liver enzymes and hepatomegaly. And hence the relevance of intervening at this stage, because one can never predict when persistently raised liver enzymes can silently progress on to secondary biliary cirrhosis. So after having assessed the anatomy and the indication in a given patient, the final call is taken based on our understanding of the advantages and limitations of each surgical procedure. So the surgical procedures that we have in our armamentarium for EHPVO are the shunt procedures, which could be total or selective, a mesenteric left portal vein bypass, which is actually not a shunt because the term shunt implies that there is an anastomosis between a vein of the portal venous system and a vein of the systemic venous system. So a mesenteric left portal vein bypass is actually a portal reperfusion procedure. So total shunts are called total because they decompress all the compartments of the portal venous system and they divert all portal flow away from the liver. They have been the most popular shunts for EHPVO so far because not only do they decompress the gastroesophageal varices, they also decompress a large spleen, ectopic varices, portal cavernoma cholangiopathy, and they enhance growth. And they have been associated with low rebleed rates. total shunts are splenorenal shunts and mesocaval shunts. And splenorenal shunt could either be a splenectomy with central end to side splenorenal shunt or a side to side splenorenal shunt. And I will go over the advantages and limitations of each. So the obvious advantage of splenectomy with central end to side splenorenal shunt is that it eliminates all issues related to a massive splenomegaly. And that is the reason why this has been the commonest shunt in our experience as well. But its limitation is that a central splenorenal shunt has a relatively higher incidence of shunt block as compared to a side-to-side splenorenal shunt or a mesocaval shunt because of angulation and because of post-splenectomy thrombocytosis. And angulation occurs because there might be a twist in the lie of the splenic vein or because of redundancy on account of over-enthusiastic mobilization of the splenic vein. Especially because at the time of doing the anastomosis, the pancreas and the adjacent viscera are in a state of retraction. And when the viscera fall back in their normal position, the angulation gets apparent at that point of time. And therefore, it is very important that there should be some physical reference as to which is the toe end and which is the heel end of the anastomosis prior to the beginning of the vascular anastomosis. Then the operating time and the blood loss is greater because splenectomy in EHO is demanding. There is a small risk of post-splenectomy sepsis in children, and it is not a very ideal shunt for small splenic vein size, say less than 5 millimeter, by virtue of the end to side nature of the vascular anastomosis. And therefore, we would opt for the shunt when the indication for surgery is massive splenomegaly with severe hypersplenism, with or without other sequelae of portal hypertension, preferably with a good diameter splenic vein. So as a corollary, the advantage of a side-to-side splenorenal shunt is that it permits a wider diameter vascular anastomosis with a relatively smaller diameter splenic vein, meaning thereby that with a 5 millimeter splenic vein, one can achieve a vascular anastomosis of around 15 millimeter. And it is associated with a lesser risk of angulation and twisting because the splenic vein is held in its normal anatomical position because it is anchored at both the ends. And it is a spleen-preserving shunt. But the limitations are that it is less effective for massive splenomegaly and severe hypersplenism. And in older patients, say, well-built young adults who have thick retroperitoneum and a wide separation between the splenic vein and the renal vein, sometimes approximating the two can be quite a challenge. And I can recollect a patient, an 18-year-old, well-built male, wherein we started with a plan of a side-to-side splenorenal shunt, but despite adequate mobilization of the splenic vein, we realized that approximating the two was quite a struggle, so we decided to convert it to a splenectomy and end-to-side splenorenal shunt. But otherwise, in smaller children, this is a good shunt. So we would choose a side-to-side splenorenal shunt when there is absence of significant issues related to massive splenomegaly. And in a small diameter splenic vein, this side-to-side splenorenal shunt would have an advantage over end-to-side splenorenal shunt. Mesocaval shunt, again, it has a lesser risk of angulation as compared to an end-to-side splenorenal shunt, and it is a spleen-preserving shunt. So we would opt for the shunt when there is absence of issues related to a massive spleen, and when we have a good length and diameter of the infraduodenal part of the superior mesenteric vein. Now, selective shunts are so called because they selectively decompress one compartment of the portosplenomesenteric venous system. So a distal splenorenal shunt compartmentalizes the portal venous system into two compartments, a decompressed gastrosplenic circuit wherein the gastroesophageal varices are decompressed via the short gastric vessels and via the splenic vein into the systemic venous system, but the superior mesenteric circuit continues to be hypertensive and that maintains prograde portal perfusion. So historically, selective shunts were evolved to take care of concerns related to the liver being deprived of all portal perfusion following total shunts in chronic liver disease, that is post-shunt encephalopathy and liver decompensation, because by maintaining prograde portal perfusion, they decrease the risk of post-shunt encephalopathy. But there are certain limitations of selective shunts, especially with reference to EHPVO. So while a selective shunt would decompress mild to moderate splenomegaly, issues related to massive splenomegaly and severe hypersplenism would persist. And because the superior mesenteric circuit continues to be hypertensive, this shunt would not take care of issues related to ectopic varices and would not be effective for portal cavernoma cholangiopathy. And for these reasons, a selective shunt has not been very popular for EHPVO in our country. And I thought it was worthwhile emphasizing this aspect because when we read series from groups who are proponents of a Mesorex bypass, their approach is that if the anatomy is suitable for a Mesorex bypass, they would proceed with a Mesorex bypass. But if the anatomy is not suitable for a Mesorex bypass, they would switch over to a distal splenorenal shunt because they have concerns about minimal hepatic encephalopathy. But the number of patients and the follow-up following distal splenorenal shunt is short. So we do not know how many of these patients would evolve into ectopic varices or portal cavernoma cholangiopathy in late adolescence or early adulthood. And this has greater relevance with respect to EHO as compared to chronic liver disease, because the disease onset is earlier and the life expectancy of the patient is longer in EHPVO as compared to chronic liver disease. Now, a mesenteric left portal vein bypass actually represents a paradigm shift in the management of EHPVO. And unlike the portosystemic shunts that we have discussed so far, it is a portal reperfusion procedure with a curative approach. And essentially, it entails placement of a vein graft, which is usually an autologous jugular vein graft, between the superior mesenteric vein and the left branch of the portal vein in the recess of Rex. So the next question that needs to be addressed is that what is the relevance of a mesenteric left portal vein bypass in EHPVO, wherein the liver architecture and function are presumably normal? So for that, let's go back to the consequences and pathophysiology of EHPVO. One, that it leads to portal hypertension. Secondly, the liver is relatively deprived of portal perfusion, which carries hepatotrophic factors for a long period of time. And this manifests as coagulation abnormalities. Mild elevation of INR, say up to 1.5, is not at all unusual in EHPVO children. And it also impairs liver growth. I mean, for any shunt surgeon, it is very clear that one of these lobes of the liver looks small in children with EHPVO. Then it opens up natural portosystemic shunts, because of which cerebral enterotoxins, especially ammonia, bypass hepatic degradation, and this is believed to predispose to minimal hepatic encephalopathy. So the next question is, do total shunts predispose to encephalopathy in EHPVO? Now, there are several landmark surgical series which have reported zero overt encephalopathy following total shunts in extrahepatic portal vein obstruction. These are studies from our own country, from AIIMS and from PGI Chandigarh, and they are French studies by Bismuth and Alvarez and Allegheny, and study by Orloff, and they have all reported zero overt encephalopathy. But studies in the last two decades have raised concerns about the possibility of minimal hepatic encephalopathy, which could manifest in the form of mild neurocognitive defects. So it could be in the form of shortening of the attention span, and the parent may notice that the child's school performance is deteriorating, or there might be a change in the temperament of the patient, or there might be a change in the sleeping pattern of the patient. So conceptually, a mesenteric left portal vein bypass is a curative procedure because it restores hepatopoietal blood flow. And by doing so, it corrects deranged INR, it reverses minimal hepatic encephalopathy, and it enhances liver and somatic growth. And in this study from Dr. Supirana's group, published in JACS 2013, they have objectively documented correction of deranged INR and improvement in serum ammonia levels pre-Mesorex bypass and post-Mesorex bypass. So while a Mesorex bypass is conceptually definitely the ideal physiological restorative and curative procedures, the important questions are, what are the prerequisites? And how often is it realistically successful? And what are the post-operative issues? So prerequisites for a Mesorex bypass, we can identify as anatomical prerequisites pertaining to the extrahepatic or intrahepatic portal venous system and non-anatomical prerequisites. So a favorable extrahepatic portal venous anatomy for a mesorex bypass is a patent good diameter infraduodenal segment of the superior mesenteric vein, together with patency of the confluence of the superior mesenteric vein with the splenic vein and a patent splenic vein. Because only if this confluence and the splenic vein is patent, would the mesorex bypass not only decompress the superior mesenteric compartment, but would also decompress the gastrosplenic compartment. But more important is a favorable intrahepatic portal venous anatomy. And for that, I would refer to the study by Dr. Deville de Goya's group, which was published in the year 2014, nearly two decades after Dr. de Goya published his first experience with mesorex bypass way back in the year 1992. So in this study, they performed wedge hepatic venous photography in 89 consecutive children of EHPVO. And on the basis of that, they identified five subtypes of intrahepatic portal venous anatomy. So type A anatomy was one wherein the entire intrahepatic portal venous system was patent. The veins had good caliber with a uniform regular outline and the confluence was patent, meaning thereby that there was good communication between the left and the right portal venous system. And this anatomy was present in 29% of all patients. Type B anatomy was one wherein the left-sided portal venous system was hypoplastic with this irregular configuration of the walls. Type C anatomy referred to thrombosis of the right-sided portal venous system with obliteration of the confluence. Type D anatomy referred to thrombosis of the left-sided portal venous system, and type E anatomy referred to diffuse involvement of the entire intrahepatic portal venous system. So a favorable anatomy, which permitted a successful mesorex bypass and also ensured long-term patency of the mesorex bypass, was only the type A anatomy, which means an anatomy wherein the entire intrahepatic portal venous system was patent with good caliber veins with uniform lumen and a patent confluence. And it is important to note that this anatomy was present in only and only 29% of all EHPVO cases evaluated by wedge hepatic venous photography. Then the other non-anatomical prerequisites are exclusion of an intrinsic prothrombotic states. Neonatal umbilical vein catheterization has been found to be an independent predictor of unfavorable anatomy and outcome, because babies who have had umbilical vein catheterization, the process of thrombosis begins from the left portal vein, unlike idiopathic EHPVO, wherein the main trunk of the portal vein is more often involved. And then availability of appropriate intervention radiology support is important, which I will explain in my subsequent slides. And then a mesorex bypass is not the most appropriate procedure when massive splenomegaly related issues, that is clinically symptomatic hypersplenism or a painful splenic infarct, affect quality of life adversely and form the primary indication for surgery. And then what are the post-surgical issues? There is a greater need for post-bypass endovascular or surgical reintervention procedures to sustain bypass patency, reported to range from 17%, this is from Dr. Supirana's group, to 28%, this is a French series by Guerin et al. The site of stenosis is usually the junction of the graft with the left branch of the portal vein, because the left branch of the portal vein is hypoplastic, the prograde portal perfusion is poor, and there is a little posterior angulation to the anastomosis here. And over a period of time, the adjacent liver parenchyma, that is segment 3 and 4, may grow to compress the graft. So let us have a look at the results of our standard portosystemic shunts and compare it with the mesorex bypass. Standard portosystemic shunts, operative mortality of the elective surgery in experienced hands has been nearly zero. This mortality from the AIM study is related to emergency shunts, because the mortality of emergency shunts is always higher than that of elective surgery. The shunt thrombosis rates range from 2.5% to 13%. Mesenteric left portal vein bypass, the number of patients were relatively small. The follow-up duration is relatively short, and shunt thrombosis rates have ranged from 8% to 18%, and this is after some of the anastomoses had been salvaged in the early postoperative period by endovascular reintervention. Now, after having addressed portal decompression surgery, what is the role of non-shunt procedures? Now, in an elective situation, one would always prefer to perform a portal decompression procedure. But if the indication for surgery is a non-shuntable anatomy with bleed from large isolated gastric varices, wherein endotherapy has failed with or without significant splenomegaly-related issues, then one may be forced to take recourse to a gastroesophageal devascularization. But when the indication for surgery is emergency surgery for uncontrolled bleed, then the surgeon may elect to opt for a GE devascularization as compared to an emergency shunt, because the mortality of an emergency shunt is higher as compared to the mortality of an emergency devascularization procedure. But because these procedures will not decompress hypertensive portal venous system, they have higher rebleed on long-term follow-up, and there is risk of manifestation of ectopic varices and portal cavernomocular angiopathy on long-term follow-up, which is again a problem which is more relevant to EHPVO as compared to chronic liver disease. And this was very appropriately demonstrated by one of our own patients. This girl, we operated upon first at the age of 12 years. We performed a gastroesophageal devascularization and splenectomy for a non-shuntable anatomy. And she came back to us 10 years later at the age of 22 years with life-threatening small bowel bleed. A CT angio suggested small bowel varices, which on intraoperative enteroscopy was demonstrated to be jejunal varices, and we had to resect the segment. So this can be a long-term sequelae of doing a gastroesophageal devascularization in a young patient with EHPVO. So based on the anatomy and indications, a suggested algorithm can be as follows: that if the indication for surgery is variceal bleed with or symptomatic portal cavernomocular angiopathy, and there are no significant splenomegaly related issues, and the anatomy is shuntable, then we would opt for a spleen preserving procedure. The ideal would be a mesenterical left portal vein bypass if the intrahepatic and extrahepatic portal venous anatomy is favorable, or else it could be a side-to-side splenorenal shunt or a mesocaval shunt. On the other hand, if the indication for surgery is massive splenomegaly with severe hypersplenism with or without variceal bleed or symptomatic PCC, and the anatomy is shuntable, we would elect to do a splenectomy because this is the major cause of morbidity in that patient, and combine it concomitantly with a photosystemic shunt. So this brings us to our next important question, that if hypersplenism is the primary indication for surgery and varices have been eradicated by endotherapy, should a shunt surgery be added to splenectomy? And this is a very common scenario in our practice, because we've had a very active department of gastroenterology who are very enthusiastic about endotherapy. The answer is a definite yes if the splenic vein is shuntable, because splenectomy inevitably results in splenic vein thrombosis, and hence loss of a shuntable vein should the patient present with other delayed sequelae of EHPVO. Moreover, doing a splenectomy alone without concomitant portal decompression may actually exacerbate portal hypertension, because the spleen acts as a pop-up valve and it bears the brunt of raised portal pressures by continuous enlargement. And therefore, in the presence of a shuntable anatomy, splenectomy alone should be strongly discouraged. So I'll conclude on the right surgical procedure by saying that a mesenterical left portal vein bypass is conceptually an ideal portal reperfusion procedure. But its caveats are its technical feasibility in a small subset with favorable anatomy, reported to be only 29% based on wedge hepatic venous portography; a greater need for post-procedure endovascular reintervention, reported to range from 17% to 28%, and it is not the most appropriate procedure when massive splenomegaly predominantly affects quality of life adversely. And therefore, for a remaining large subset of patients, with anatomy and indications not favorable for a mesorex bypass, the standard portosystemic shunts continue to hold a valuable role. And therefore, any surgeon who's treating patients with EHPVO need to have a wide spectrum of procedures in his or her armamentarium to be able to provide the best option to a given patient tailored to the anatomy and indications. So that finishes the first part of my presentation. So do we have time, Dr. Radhakrishnan? Should I continue or should we pause for...
No, we have enough time, ma'am. We can, because there's no other lecture after this, so you can carry on as long as you...
So should we take questions and comments at this stage, or should I finish the pre-operative preparation and post-operative management?
Yeah, we'll finish off everything,
okay.
And then...
Okay. So preoperatively, for any operative procedure which is likely to entail a splenectomy, we immunize all our children for pneumococcus, meningococcus, H influenzae. This should ideally be given 10 to 12 weeks prior, or at least 2 weeks prior to splenectomy. But if pre-splenectomy immunization is missed, say because it was an emergency surgery wherein splenectomy was not anticipated, then it should be administered 2 weeks post-splenectomy, because it has been documented that in the first 2 weeks following a splenectomy, the body does not mount an adequate antibody response. Now, a very common clinical dilemma which is faced by surgeons and more importantly by anesthetists, EHPVO with severe hypersplenism and significant thrombocytopenia. Is preoperative platelet transfusion really warranted? Interestingly, when I was discussing this topic with Dr. Radhakrishnan on the phone, his first comment was that in South India, when we post patients with EHO for surgery, our anesthetists ask for large volumes of platelets and large volumes of FFP to be arranged. And I could really identify with him because all of us have gone through similar phases. So the answer is hardly ever, because the platelet function here is normal. And hence, even significant thrombocytopenia rarely leads to surgically troublesome bleed, meaning thereby that the connotation of a platelet count of 20,000 to 30,000 in an EHPVO is different from a platelet count of 20,000 or 30,000 in chronic liver disease or in sepsis. Because in the latter two conditions, not only is the platelet count low, the platelet function is also impaired. Moreover, splenic artery ligation as the first step in splenectomy leads to a gradual rise in platelet count. And therefore, the only few situations where I can recollect that we have infused platelets on the operating table after induction of anesthesia were patients who had spontaneous skin bleeds and the anesthetists were concerned about oozing from the central venous site, CVP site insertion.
Dr. Richard, if I can interrupt you for a minute. Sujay wants to ask some questions because he has to leave for, he's got a hospital call, if you don't mind. Sujay, please come in.
Okay, Sujay.
Sorry, Richard, it was a brilliant presentation. I mean, it was a refreshing insight into some other perspectives on portal hypertension, which sort of we get regimented in AIMS, as you understand, with our experience. And I mean, we hardly ever think laterally. I would be interested in knowing what your personal experience with mesorex shunt is. How much is it? How many have you done?
I have not had an opportunity of doing a mesorex shunt, but barring mesorex shunt, we have had an opportunity of doing central splenorenal shunts, side-to-side splenorenal shunts, mesocable, and some IMV shunts also. And the reason for this is that as an institutional protocol, all our patients receive endotherapy first, and they come to us after endoscopic eradication of varices when they have some delayed sequelae. And therefore, vast majority of our patients have large spleens and splenomegaly-related issues. So they actually do not, as far as the indications are concerned, they do not qualify for a mesorex bypass. So I have not had an opportunity to really do or kind of learn this procedure. But I thought that it was important to have an insight on it.
So because one of our residents did a thesis on the portal vein anatomy in EHO. Yeah. And we also came up with the figure of 75%, the left portal vein is not available.
Yeah.
I mean, it's totally obliterated. So there goes the anatomical indication for doing a shunt. And the second thing was, since we are predominantly dealing with adult patients, it could mean that internal jugular vein is not suitable. The length is not suitable for bridging the distance between the SMV to the left portal vein.
Yeah.
That's something which I felt technically it may not be feasible. So you'll end up using a Gore-Tex graft, which has its own complications and on a subsequent thrombosis rates and all those things.
Yeah.
So combine these together, I mean, somehow I feel the Baveno 6 has overplayed its intention by, you know, advocating Mesorex bypass for cases with EHO. I don't think it is correct. And this perspective should be, you know, highlighted as far as we go with all these graphs.
Yeah, agreed with you.
Do you agree with that?
Yeah, so that is why if the anatomy is favorable for a Mesorex bypass, one can say that it is a really a beautiful procedure because it literally cures the patient of the disease. But yes, there are limitations related to the anatomy, and only in a small percentage of patients would a favorable anatomy permit a Mesorex bypass.
And the second comment I had was that you felt that the mesogavel shunts work well. In our experience, the mesogavel shunts are prone to more thrombosis rates. And their decompression of the varices also doesn't happen, very effectively in most instances. So we have used it only as a fallback option in those patients who have had shunt blocks.
So that may be related to the fact, Sujoy, that you must be using prosthetic grafts rather than autologous vein grafts, is it?
In adults, that's what we end up doing.
Yeah. So prosthetic grafts are always associated with higher thrombosis rates. In children, we are fortunate. By and large, we use autologous vein grafts, and autologous vein grafts definitely have lesser thrombosis rates.
Good
and
that course,
and also, we are a little meticulous about post-operative anticoagulation. Yeah. So we do give post-operative anticoagulation, unlike, I think, the AIMS protocol, where you do not give any anticoagulation in the post-operative period.
We do not believe in any post-operative.
Yeah.
And I mean, again, the same thing about minimal encephalopathy. We are right now starting a study on looking at it again. But as far as we are concerned, we felt that encephalopathy was never an issue in EHO. It was an issue in non-cirrhotic portal fibrosis, but never in EHO. That was our take.
Yeah. So, Sujoy, we have published our experience with minimal hepatic encephalopathy pre-shunt and post-shunt. And this was based on a very detailed neuropsychiatric evaluation based on MR spectroscopy, based on EEGs and serum ammonia levels. And that study showed that 33% of all EHO patients had evidence of minimal hepatic encephalopathy even prior to a shunt. And there was a small rise in minimal hepatic encephalopathy post-shunt, but the difference between pre-shunt and post-shunt was not statistically significant. But the clinical relevance of that, one has to kind of really figure out. I mean, this was based on MR spectroscopy and EEGs and detailed clinical evaluation.
So I really enjoyed listening to you, and I'm sorry I won't be able to continue, but please carry on.
Thank you, Sujoy. Thank you for your comments.
Thank
you for joining over.
Thanks, Sujoy. Thank you.
Right, brother. Thank you.
So a similar clinical dilemma is that mild preoperative elevation in INR up to 1.5 in EHPVO, should that be a cause for concern? Again, the answer is hardly ever, because mild elevation in INR is not unusual in EHPVO. The possible explanation for which is the liver being relatively deprived of portal perfusion and hepatotrophic factors for a long period of time. And this again rarely manifests as surgically troublesome bleed. And in fact, we need to emphasize that overzealous infusion of platelets and FFP and cryos and procoagulant factors intraoperatively can actually jeopardize our vascular anastomosis and prove to be counterproductive and therefore should be discouraged. So in the same vein, in the postoperative period, we should avoid overzealous infusion of blood, platelets and fresh frozen plasma. A hemoglobin of 8 g/cent corresponding to a hematocrit of 24% is just right, because post-meniectomy thrombocytosis and a hypercoagulable state may jeopardize the patency of vascular anastomosis, and we do not want any intravascular sludging. Then other aspects that need to be addressed are anticoagulation, assessment of shunt patency, and prophylaxis for post-splenectomy sepsis. Now, anticoagulation, when I reviewed literature, there is lack of a uniform protocol across different centers. All of series reports no anticoagulation. The AIM series gives single intraoperative dose of heparin, 100 international units per kg, prior to vascular anastomosis. The PGI Chandigarh group gives intraoperative heparin, which is continued postoperatively till day 7. And Deville de Goyer's group and this is Dr. Suparina's group, they give intraoperative heparin, which is continued postoperatively till day 7. And they actually give double antiplatelet agents, aspirin and dipyrimidovore, which is continued for 6 months. So we at SGPGIMS give intraoperative heparin, 100 international units per kg prior to the vascular anastomosis, which we continue postoperatively till day 7, and we continue with oral aspirin for 6 months. Now, our imaging protocol for shunt patency assessment has been a Doppler on day 7, followed by a 6-monthly Doppler for 2 years and a yearly Doppler thereafter. And if on any of these Dopplers, we are not able to visualize the shunt, then we would do a CT portovenogram. Because the Doppler usually underestimates the patency of these shunts, because anatomically these shunts are located deep into the retroperitoneum, and their evaluation on the ultrasound may be difficult because of being obscured by overlapping bowel gas or mesenteric fat. We do 1 upper GI endoscopy at 6 months following surgery, at which if we can document significant downgrading of varices, and after which if the shunt continues to be patent, then there is no need to subject this patient to repeated endoscopies. So this is a CT portovenogram which shows a good patent splenorenal shunt. And this is another of our patient wherein the CT portovenogram showed a shunt stenosis, which was detected because on a upper GI endoscopy done at 6 months, we found that there was no downgrading of varices. So this was salvaged by percutaneous transfemoral balloon angioplasty by our intervention radiologist. Similarly, downgrading of varices at review endoscopy performed at 6 months following surgery, or improving hemogram and regressing splenic size in spleen preserving shunt procedures are other surrogate markers of a well-functioning shunt. About post-splenectomy sepsis, how much is the risk and what should be the prophylaxis? Again, there is lack of a uniform protocol across various centers. The AIM study, which was published in the year 1994, reported one case out of 160 cases of pneumococcal meningitis. Surprisingly, they reported a fairly high incidence of malaria after splenectomy, but they did not recommend any pre-op immunization or post-splenectomy prophylaxis. A smaller series of pediatric cases from PGI Chandigarh reported 0 OPSI, but they immunized all their children for pneumococcus and H influenzae and continued with oral penicillin prophylaxis for 2 years. So we at SGPGI also immunize all our patients preoperatively, and we continue amoxicillin prophylaxis for 2 years following surgery. So we have a modest experience of 138 pediatric cases of EHO. If we add the adult data also, the numbers of SGPGI would be much larger. And from that data, I have selected some representative case capsules, each representing a different indication and a different procedure based on the anatomy. So I hope there would be a useful message from each of these cases. So case one was a 9-year-old child. The indication for surgery was symptomatic portal cavernoma cholangiopathy in the form of recurrent cholestatic jaundice. The LFT showed conjugated hyperbilirubinemia. The GGT was elevated up to 5 times of normal. There were no significant splenomegaly related issues, and the varices had been eradicated by endoscopy. On MRCP, there was this typical indentation with intrahepatic biliary dilatation, narrowing at the confluence, a dilated CBD, and sludge at the lower end. So we did an MR portovenogram, which reported a thrombosed splenic vein, but fortunately the superior mesenteric vein was 9 millimeter with a good length in the intrapancreatic part. So we elected to perform edge graft interposition mesocubital shunt because it is a total shunt and it would decompress the portal cavernoma cholangiopathy, and this child did not have any splenomegaly related issues, so we would always prefer a spleen preserving shunt. So the intraoperative liver biopsy showed bile ductural proliferation with bridging fibrosis, which suggested long standing biliary obstruction because of portal cavernoma cholangiopathy. Following the mesocaval shunt, we put this child on UDCA, and after 3 years with a persistently patent shunt, the LFTs of this child had normalized. So I thought this case had a good message. It represents symptomatic portal cavernoma cholangiopathy with histological evidence of significant liver fibrosis presenting in the first decade of life, wherein timely shunt surgery resulted in normalization of liver function profile. Case two was another child wherein the indication for surgery was reckoned bleed from secondary large isolated gastric varices, IgV1F3 with failed prior glue injection. The term secondary implies that these varices have appeared after primary endotherapy. Again, the child did not have significant splenomegaly related issues. So this was the CT portovenogram, which shows a 6 millimeter splenic vein, and the superior mesenteric vein was replaced by collaterals. So we opted for a side-to-side splenorenal shunt because it would decompress isolated gastric varices. Then the child did not have any splenomegaly related issues, so we would prefer a spleen preserving shunt. And in a small diameter splenic vein, that is a 6 millimeter vein, a side-to-side anastomosis gives a wider diameter as compared to an end-to-side anastomosis. Case three, the indication for surgery was hematochezia, and this was the colonoscopy, which shows large anorectal varices. Hematology showed severe hypersplenism. Gastroesophageal varices had been eradicated by endotherapy 3 years ago. And this was the CT portovenogram, which shows a 4 millimeter inferior mesenteric vein, which is communicating with the splenic vein. The splenic vein itself was 10 millimeter in diameter. The superior mesenteric vein, however, was replaced with collaterals. So we elected to do a splenectomy with central end-to-side splenorenal shunt because the splenic vein was communicating with the IMB and therefore would decompress the anorectal varices, and the splenectomy would take care of his severe hypersplenism. So this is 5 years after the splenorenal shunt. The shunt was patent. The child did not have any hematochezia. And this is the post-surgery colonoscopy, which shows significant regression of anorectal varices. Case four, the indication for surgery was massive splenomegaly with clinically symptomatic hypersplenism in the form of spontaneous skin bleeds and menorrhagia. This adolescent had a precariously low platelet count. Her platelets were 10,000. And interestingly, she was a non-bleeder. And an upper GI endoscopy was done just as a part of routine workup for EHPVO, which showed large esophageal varices, for which she was put on prophylactic endotherapy. This was a MR portovenogram, which shows a 10 millimeter splenic vein. The SMV was again not amenable for a shunt. So we did a splenectomy with a concomitant central end-to-side splenorenal shunt because it would ameliorate her symptomatic hypersplenism, and a concomitant splenorenal shunt was added to prevent any delayed secular portal hypertension because her splenic vein was shuntable. Then case five, the indication for surgery was recurrent bleed from large isolated gastric funnel varices, IGV-F3, with massive splenomegaly and severe hypersplenism. There was a past history of glue injection for previous episodes of isolated gastric variceal bleed. So our endoscopist said that they had nothing further to offer to the child. And on CT portovenography, unfortunately, the splenic vein, the superior mesenteric vein, inferior mesenteric vein, all the three veins were thrombosed, and there were these large, formidable looking gastric varices. So we elected to do splenectomy with gastroesophageal devascularization, because it would take emergent control of bleed from isolated gastric varices and would also take care of issues related to massive splenomegaly. So this is my last and on a personal level, the most important slide. I wish to appreciate the LGS team because not only are they doing a very good job in sharing knowledge, I think they are doing a very good job in connecting surgeons across the country of various generations, and most importantly, keeping our spirits as surgeons high, especially in times like this when everything seems to be overshadowed by the grim realities of the pandemic. And to my mentors, I'm very happy that Professor Vinay Kapoor is there, and he has shaped my growth as a surgeon in so many ways, and our students and our patients who add value to whatever we do. So thank you all for sitting up till late in the evening for listening to this talk. And if there's some questions and some comments from senior surgeons.
It's a wonderful talk, ma'am. And actually, as Sujay was saying that, you know, from AIMS, we are one-sided. We never knew that extrahepatic portal venous obstruction has got so many other aspects to it. So it opens up new vistas to us. Thank you so much. It's a very, very nicely delivered lecture. We'll start with Pradhaban. What is your comment or question? Pradhaban is chief of JSA3 from Calicut. Yeah, Pradhaban.
Okay. Good evening, madam.
Good evening.
I have three things to add. First thing, entrap EHPVO. Does really worsens the chance of recovering portal videopathy in otherwise recoverable patient, because early endotherapy actually develops portal videopathy earlier when you compare to a child who undergoes endotherapy after. So the timing of endotherapy has something to do with the development of portal videopathy. That is one thing, because if there is a shuntable vein to begin with in a patient with the symptomatic EHPVO, I prefer to have a shunt surgery rather than doing endotherapy and waiting for the child to develop portal videopathy. What is your opinion on that?
Yeah, so Prathapan, I could not hear the first part of your question very clearly. Like, is it that you were saying that endotherapy may exacerbate portal cavernoma cholangiopathy? Was that your first question?
Yeah, yes, yes.
Yeah. So yes, that has been, yeah, so that has been one of the conjectures, because endotherapy actually obliterates the natural portosystemic collateral. So the pressures are continuously elevated. So somewhere those elevated portal pressures would manifest. So they either manifest in the form of secondary gastric varices or ectopic varices. And yes, there is a school of thought which says that endotherapy may actually predispose to increased incidence of portal cavernoma cholangiopathy. So that is there. Although, I mean, one cannot say that there are perfect case control studies where you had a cohort of patients who were offered surgery earlier and a cohort of patients who were given endotherapy and then they were followed over a long period of time. And then a comparison was made as to how many of the patients with primary endotherapy developed portal cavernoma cholangiopathy and how many patients who underwent surgery developed portal cavernoma cholangiopathy. So scientifically speaking, we do not have those kind of longitudinal studies to compare. But yes, there is a school of thought wherein it is felt that endotherapy can actually increase the risk of portal cavernoma cholangiopathy because it alters the pattern of collateralization. About your second comment that you would like to offer surgery to any patient who has a shuntable anatomy after endoscopic control of first major bleed episode. Yes, I mean, the AIMS group still practices that. There are many centers that would practice. It is just that, you know, in SGPGIMS, we have had this kind of a protocol right from the beginning that every patient of EHPVO first goes to pediatric gastroenterology. And if that patient right at the presentation has large isolated gastric varices or ectopic varices or PCC or very huge spleen, then they would refer the patient for surgery directly. But if that patient has gastroesophageal varices, then they would eradicate first by endotherapy, put on long-term surveillance and refer to us for delayed sequelae. The only thing I would say is about logistics, Prathapan, because at SGPGI, we have a huge, huge volume of EHPVO children, and our waiting time for surgery is more than a year. So in that sense, we are a little thankful that, you know, our gastroenterologists put these patients on endotherapy program, because otherwise we would lose many of these children while they were waiting because of recurrent bleed. So one has to really look at the volume of the patients, the operating time available, the number of centers that are capable of offering surgery with good results. And there is absolutely nothing wrong in offering surgery to them after endoscopic control of first major bleed episode of the anatomy shuntable. That is a perfectly reasonable approach.
The second thing about managing portal biliopathy, because we have to manage portal biliopathy more than the bleed of extrahepatic portal hypertension now. The second issue I want to ask about, who has non-shuntable vein, prevent some devascularization procedures of frank portal biliopathy like strictures. You said direct biliary surgery has got some many complications, chances of shunt, blockage of anastomosis is higher. So we had to operate for such patients, because patient had biliary stricture, stones, they were having severe cholangitis. As you rightly said, they all developed development strictures later after 7 or 8 years. So what is the ideal approach in those patients where there is no shuntable vessels but having symptomatic portal biliopathy?
So, I mean, I would give my perspective, but fortunately as a pediatric surgeon, I see less of portal cavernoma cholangiopathy. So maybe I will request Professor Kapoor to answer this question after I have given my perspective. So Prathapan, if there is a non-shuntable anatomy with symptomatic portal cavernoma cholangiopathy, then essentially it has to be a management which is based on endoscopy and on intervention radiology. So a patient is committed to lifelong endoscopic interventions and you know, sometimes a combination of percutaneous intervention plus endoscopy. And Dr. Kapoor, sir, is Dr. Kapoor here?
Yeah. Yes, I am here.
Dr.
Prathapan, that's a very difficult situation to handle, because we all know that the treatment of portal biliopathy is portal decompression, but there is no shuntable vein. So as Richa said, that these patients have to be on recurrent, repeated, lifelong endoscopic and radiological management. And ultimately, at the end of the journey, transplant may be on the cards.
Yeah. Right. Thank you.
There are two questions in the chat box, ma'am. One is, which shunt has the highest chance of post-shunt and hepatic encephalopathy?
So, any of the total shunts would have a comparable risk of post-shunt encephalopathy. I mean, that is first that we believe that there is a significant risk of post-shunt hepatic encephalopathy in EHPVO. So if we are ready to believe that, then any of the total shunts would have an equal risk, whether it is a central splenorenal shunt or a mesocaval shunt. A side-to-side splenorenal shunt also behaves like a total shunt only. Distal splenorenal shunts would have a lesser risk, but over a period of time, we know that distal splenorenal shunts also get transformed into total shunts. And mesorex bypass, of course, if it is technically feasible, it's a beautiful operation, because it would just kind of take care of all these issues.
The same gentleman asked another question, a little strange question, that is there a risk of cirrhosis and long-term follow-up of portosystemic shunts? Risk of cirrhosis.
Is there a risk of cirrhosis?
In the long-term follow-up of patients after shunts. Post-shunt surgery, do they develop cirrhosis? I mean, the question doesn't seem to be scientific, but you know, that's what was the question. I want exactly. And have you ever seen any of your EHO patients, due course of time, developing some sort of a nodularity and non-cirrhotic portal papillomas, or even cirrhosis?
So, I mean, if the patient has portal cavernoma cholangiopathy, And if the anatomy is such that the shunt is not decompressing the collaterals in the hepatodural ligament, because you see, if you are doing a, we look at it like this, that if you are doing a splenorenal shunt, that splenorenal shunt is going to decompress portal cavernoma cholangiopathy only if the splenic vein and the superior mesenteric vein are communicating with each other and the confluence of the superior mesenteric vein and the splenic vein are patent, because by and large, the venous drainage of the CBD goes into the superior mesenteric vein. So for this unusual question, I'm just trying to think of an unusual situation that supposing we've done a shunt and it's a splenorenal shunt, but the anatomy is such that it is not decompressing the hepatodural ligament, and over a period of time, this patient develops portal cavernoma cholangiopathy, then this patient can evolve into secondary biliary cirrhosis. And secondary biliary cirrhosis consequent to portal cavernoma cholangiopathy, we have seen in children. I mean, I presented one surgical case, but I also know that there are two or three children who are with pediatric gastroenterology with secondary biliary cirrhosis because of portal cavernoma cholangiopathy, but they did not come to us because their anatomy was also unfortunately unshuntable.
Yeah, the next question by Niranjan is, what is the minimum diameter of the splenic vein to consider it as a shuntable vein?
So Niranjan, actually, as I said, that would vary with the comfort of the surgeon and the surgical experience and technical expertise. So as I said, that for us, we would say that any vein which is 5 millimeter or more, we would be okay about doing a shunt. Although there are certain specific technical do's and don'ts when you are making an anastomosis with a relatively smaller diameter veins. But then there are more, I would say, experienced surgeons. So if you look at Friend series, they have done shunts with veins as small as 2 millimeters in diameter also. And although smaller veins are associated with higher shunt block rates. So each surgeon has to assess his or her comfort level. So, I mean, we would say that vein which is 5 millimeter or more in diameter with adequate intraoperative technical precautions in terms of, you know, making an adequate tutling of the vein, in terms of giving interrupted sutures on the anterior layer, et cetera, we would consider for anastomosis. So a vein more than 5 millimeter, this is what my answer would be personally.
Dr. Vijay Reddy asks, question says, is there any role for splenic artery embolization in any clinical scenario of EHPV?
So EHPVO, by and large, it would always be preferable to do a splenectomy rather than do a splenic artery embolization, because we have to remember that these are children where we are looking forward towards a near normal life expectancy. Splenic artery embolization is more of a temporizing procedure in patients with chronic liver disease, you know, who are awaiting a liver transplantation, because splenic artery embolization has its own problems. I mean, it can lead to a splenic infarct, and that splenic infarct can evolve into an abscess, and that abscess itself can be a problem. And so because these patients tolerate surgery very well, we are looking forward towards a near normal life expectancy, we would always prefer to do a splenectomy if the spleen is creating problems rather than go for splenic artery embolization. But if somebody in the audience has some other views on splenic artery embolization for EHPV or some special scenario, definitely, I mean, anybody's observations would be most
welcome. I'll ask Dr. Kapoor to pitch in here.
Well, I don't think, I'll agree with Richa. I don't think we have ever done splenic artery embolization either as a preparatory step or as the definitive treatment.
So, Madhavan?
No, I have seen only in situations of post-transplant hypersplenism situations, where they do splenic artery embolization rather than this. Other than that, we don't usually do splenic artery embolization because, as Madam said, their chances of infarction in a massive splenomegaly is very high. But we do splenic artery ligation intraoperatively if we don't have any other options. Sometimes that may just control the hypersplenism part, and later we will plan second surgery like that.
So splenic artery ligation is always done as a first step towards splenectomy in all EHO patients. In all EHO patients wherein splenectomy is planned.
No, even without splenectomy, we may sometimes do splenic artery ligation.
So you are talking
that may actually decrease the flow to the spleen and may control hypertension.
Are you referring to gastroesophageal devascularization, wherein the
patient is too sick? We don't do splenectomy. We do only devascularization to splenic artery ligation.
This is the approach which Professor S.K. Mathur had reported in a series, that avoiding splenectomy in a sick patient and doing splenic artery ligation and devascularization.
No, we can always plan a second stage devascularization because we don't get time to assess the splenic vein in that situation. That may be
okay. Okay.
Now, I have a couple of questions. One is, have you seen a sudden growth spurt after shunt surgery in children, which was seen in the All India Institute group?
Yeah, growth spurt is very remarkable. The improvement in quality of life is very remarkable in these children. So about that, there is no doubt. The improvement.
Yeah, what is the physiology behind growth spurt?
So I'll tell you theoretically, and then I will come to what our observation is. So theoretically, the growth spurt is because the big spleen itself leads to chronic anemia. And big spleen leads to chronic pain and early satiety. So these children eat poorly. So once the spleen is removed, they are relieved of their chronic anemia. They are relieved of the pain and they eat better. And secondly, it is said that raised portal pressures lead to protein losing portal hypertensive enteropathy. And once we have decompressed the portal venous system, and that protein losing enteropathy is also taken care of. And the third explanation which has been given is that the cause of growth failure is the liver being deprived of certain hepatotrophic factors which are secreted by the pancreas, and they normally reach the liver via the portal vein, especially the insulin-like growth factor which gets activated in the liver, and therefore they are believed to have growth hormone resistance. So three factors: the large spleen causing chronic anemia and loss of appetite, protein losing enteropathy, and relative growth hormone resistance. So these are the three etiologies. So splenectomy with portal decompression will take care of chronic anemia. It will take care of poor appetite because of huge spleen, and it will take care of protein losing enteropathy. In fact, if you closely question these patients, a lot of patients will say that prior to surgery, their stool frequency was something like 3 to 4 times in a day. And after surgery, their stool frequency has come down. And I mean, things that we started observing as we became more and more experienced with shunt surgery. But at the same time, we have also observed a growth spurt with patients who have had only splenectomy and devascularization, wherein the anatomy was not shuntable. So, and this has been published also in our quality of life experience publication in JPG in 2010. So, which means that if there is a growth spurt following splenectomy and devascularization also, that means the splenomegaly per se was also contributing to growth retardation because of chronic anemia and because that large spleen really, really affects their quality of life.
So, your approach is purely abdominal, or you do a thoracoabdominal approach for children?
Children, we are fortunate. I have never had to do a thoracotomy. We use a reverse McVitie's incision, an L-shaped incision, and that gives us an excellent exposure. So the children, we are kind of very comfortable.
And my last question will be, actually, when we were with Dr. Nandi, he used to say that most patients don't require any blood during surgery, but an occasional patient will have torrential bleeding, may require up to 10 units of blood. Have you seen situations like that?
So what I would say, sir, that what Dr. Nandi said, that vast majority of patients will not require blood transfusion, is actually correct. And in fact, this splenic artery ligation as a first step to splenectomy, it's a very useful step. And there has been a very beautiful study from the Department of Pediatric Surgery at AIIMS, wherein they have shown that the splenic artery ligation at the beginning of surgery, wherein the splenic vein is ligated, say, 1 hour after splenic artery ligation, leads to a lot of auto transfusion. So we have also observed that when you do serial VBGs on the operating table, if the hematocrit of the patient was, say, 24% at the start of surgery, simply by a splenic artery ligation as a first step, by the end of the surgery, the hematocrit automatically rises to 30%. So in an uneventful elective surgery, in many, many of our patients, we have been able to do away without blood transfusion. And as I said, that as long as the hematocrit is 24%, we are happy. We don't want to over-transfuse this patient. But yes, I mean, EHPVO, it's a very treacherous situation. If you are a little impatient and if, you know, any of the collaterals get pulled or torn, then one can lose liters and liters of blood within a very short period of time. And that situation, every that nightmarish situation, I guess every surgeon who operates in EHPVO in portal hypertension would have encountered.
So, sir, I'll ask Dr. Kapoor to come in with his comments. Sir wants to leave. Sir, Kapoor, sir. Kapoor, sir, are you there? I think sir is left. Prabhakaran has again an unusual question. What to do to prevent cirrhosis in these patients? I don't know how his question is framed. I will. You have any comment on that? To prevent cirrhosis in these patients.
So again, Prabhakaran, one that to begin with itself, one has to be very clear that the diagnosis is EHPVO and not EHPVO secondary to chronic liver disease, because I mean, you can have that kind of a situation. So in the first place, that is important. And secondly, again, I mean, cirrhosis in EHPVO is usually a consequence of portal cavernoma cholangiopathy. So if you can do an effective portal decompression and if you can prevent portal cavernoma cholangiopathy, then you can prevent cirrhosis. So that is what I would say.
I mean, Dr. Ratnasamy is in the audience, sir. You want to make any comment?
Sorry, nothing much. I learned a lot. Thank you so much.
Thank you, sir.
Excellent lecture.
Thank you.
Dr. Ratnasamy is the chief of surgical gastroenterology at SRM Medical College and the retired professor of surgery GE from Madras Medical College. Thank you, sir.
Thank you.
Any other question from anyone before we wind up and kept Dr. Richard here for a long time, very long time. Rather, you've been here in the previous lecture as well. Yeah. Please, anyone if you want to just unmute and come with your question, please.
So somebody has put a question in the chat box. Dr. Radhakrishnan, somebody has put a question in the chat box, which I can't actually read.
No, somebody said it's a very nice lecture, ma'am. Thank you.
No, there was a question prior to that.
That question is, ma'am, since there is shunting away of haptotrophic growth factors in total systemic shunt, will it affect liver function later?
So, yes, I mean, this concern is there, but how real is the concern? That is the question. If you look at proponents of Mesorex bypass, they would say with a lot of emphasis and conviction that doing total shunts would affect liver synthetic functions in long term. But as many, many of us from India have been doing total shunts and we have long follow-ups, and we have not encountered that. I mean, I guess that it is okay, but yes, proponents of Mesorex bypass do kind of believe that doing total shunts would predispose to liver dysfunction.
There's one more question by Niranjan. Ma'am, if patient has splenic vein thrombosis with EHPVO, does mesocaval shunt help for esophageal variceal bleeding?
So yes, Niranjan, that would be the only option. And you are right in raising the question because one would presume that a mesocaval shunt would decompress the gastroesophageal varices via the usual route that gastroesophageal varices would decompress through the short gastrics and then through the splenic vein and through the splenic vein and the superior mesenteric vein confluence. But then luckily, there's so much of collateralization and the portal venous system is valveless. And therefore, a lot of times, I mean, if you do a mesocaval shunt or you open, you do a decompression of one compartment of the portal venous system because of the collaterals and because of the entire system being valveless, and because there is that left branch of the left gastric vein being there, which opens into the portal vein. So through those alternative routes, one would expect that the esophageal varices would decompress. And in any case, in this kind of a situation, a mesocaval shunt is the only option and the best option for you, hoping that the collaterals would decompress the esophageal varices despite a thrombosed splenic vein.
Any other question or comment? If there are no questions, thank you so much, ma'am. Thanks for a wonderful lecture. And lots I've learned as well. And we hope you'll come back with another lecture soon. Thank you so much. Thanks. Thank you so much. We really enjoyed it.
Thank you.
Thanks, everyone.